friends, we all know, and I've been announcing it all these days during this Amrita Shergill National Art Week, that Naveena Sundaram is the niece of the iconic painter artist Amrita Shergill. She is her sister Indira's daughter. We are honored, privileged that she is amongst us. We really welcome you. We have a battery of talented people from the country. Here is Sadanand Menon. He is going to engage with Anju Dodia tomorrow. Then here is Atul Dodia, the iconic artist. Then here is Anju Dodia. She is going to present her thing tomorrow. Then of course we have Mithu Sen. You had seen her presentation yesterday. And Dayanita, who is going to present her works to you after Naveena. She is still engaged in photographing Corbusier buildings outside. She said she'll come a little while later. And then we have Tasneem Mehta. She's also on the way. She'll be joining us in a few moments. We are very proud, very privileged, very honored that people from all over the country who have made difference in the field of art and culture and thinking on art are here amongst us to share their thoughts and also enrich this, you know, modern city, which is painstakingly designed, maintained, and given impetus by our leaders, our bureaucrats. We are really proud of you and proud of the audience as well.
My question is to you. Most of the pictures are black and white. So any specific reason, or if you'd like to share that?
I find color very difficult. Mm. I find color of daylight tends to dominate, and I'm not able to create as much of an atmosphere as I can with black and white. I can put more of a focus into where I want to draw your attention in black and white than in color. I think it's something like that. But now I shoot in both. Mm-hmm. I shoot a lot of color, but only at night.
And what are the things which are keeping you away from the digital world? As you said, you're not using that kind of camera or something.
I like the idea that in my bag I have my camera, I have my light meter, and I have these two boxes of film. I'm showing it to you because these days your generation doesn't know all this, no? So this is film. And this is... Yeah. Medium format film, 12 exposures. So I have 10 rolls, which is 120 frames for these 2 days of my shooting in Chandigarh. It's quite a lot. I wouldn't normally shoot 10 rolls in 2 days, but because I'm here and I didn't want to run short of film, it's anyway finishing this year. Kodak will have no more film at the end of this year. So I have to think quite carefully about what I want. I also use a tripod, which is in the car, but which I'm going to get and then go to the Rose Garden. I like the way analog slows me down. I have to take a meter reading. After all of these years, I still don't trust myself completely, and I will take the reading. And then I will set my camera, and then I will realize that the film is over. Then I have to change. I have to take the whole back off. I'm happy to demonstrate that for you. But it's very much that process that keeps me with film. So now, of course, I'm thinking about digital because I have to. I don't really have to because I have photographed now for 30 years. So I have a huge archive of images, and I've used maybe 10% of it. So I have a lot of work. So I could choose not to do digital and just work with my archive, which is very fascinating, especially when you start mixing the archive. And if I go to digital, I thought, I don't like the idea of shooting in color and converting it to black and white. That's one problem. The solution for that is the Leica monochrome. It's also very expensive. But that is the one camera. Kodak made one before. But that's the only camera where the sensor is made just for black and white. So I think I would have to get that camera if there was no more film. But what I enjoy very much is working like this, you know, with the Hasselblad, looking down. I always have a very different point of view from my colleagues who are often a foot higher and with their cameras there. So look at the difference that we have. So it's not a surprise when you say that, you know, somebody might say, oh, I can tell that's a Dayanita picture. It's really nothing more than the fact that I shoot from my belly. So I'm really shooting from a child's point of view, not even my own. So I think I would go to digital, but I need a lot of things from digital. I need the square format and I need black and white. I can get the black and white on the Leica monochrome, but that doesn't give me the square format. The Hasselblad back gives me a slightly rectangular format as well. And performance for free.
And Dayanita, the way you have worked and moved now from the book into the gallery, it's another mobility of the image. I just want to both of you to reflect a bit on, you know, how, what this journey of the still image is all about and how it constructs through you know, integrating with a different medium, how it can create a completely new story. Not that it's not been done before, but, you know, it's fascinating to see these two journeys together. So whether, you know, you could pick on you know, how you worked with the still image and, you know, how that then became this very mobile film. So it's hardly a half an hour film, but it's, it spans an entire, you know, journey.
Yeah, well, thanks for that observation. As Daffy said at the beginning in my introduction, I come from journalism and I worked with television in the days actually when we had film and not videos. So there was a period where you could declare your own time. Anyhow, that has passed. But for me, when I retired and this commission came and I was asked to do something about Amrita, and I said, oh my God, I don't know anybody who's still alive who can talk on her. Because that was how my documentary tradition worked. I spoke to people who were eyewitnesses or happened to be there. Now, this was a kind of course, I was very lucky because the family archive has been carefully kept from my mother and then, of course, through Vivan and things. But to find a way of that the just the images itself create another narrative. You still see that I don't quite trust them because I have this constant commentary, as somebody said, it's relentless. But that comes from my my teaching. And I still haven't quite found a way, maybe that would be another project if I do it, that the images tell their own story without my help. And I was hoping to use the crutch of being the niece or to film, you know, to put in something personal because otherwise anybody else could have done the film. You could have done the film. But what was special about me doing this film from my background? So that was, I don't think it's a challenge that I've been able to take up completely, but I'm not totally unhappy with the result. It was something completely new for me. I don't work with that otherwise.
And I've been trying to work with stills, actually failed quite badly because I thought the Mona story was such an important story that it needs to be told to a larger audience. You know, the publisher of the Mona book went bankrupt and so the book is not available. And I thought, let me try and see if I can make a form. So I thought, brilliant, I'm going to take all these photographs and I'm going to make a movie. And I battled for 6 months with it because again, I wanted the photographs to speak. I didn't want too much of the text. At the same time, you can't take Mona's story away from her. So worked on all that and finally gave up. Because I think I understood that there is only so far that a still photograph can go. So to really make a film with still photographs like Le Jeté, which is a great film, William Klein was asked to take those pictures for the film. So now if I wanted to make a film, film out of stills of Mona, I would photograph it for the film. But right now the stills that I have from my previous project, each one is so complete in itself, there's no in between. And so either I thought I put my voice or I put random landscapes, but it was quite, I couldn't crack it. And I thought the music really helped here. Yeah. in holding the stills together, apart from your commentary. And I've now gone back to the, I've sort of feel that maybe I love projection as a form. And I love this mixing up the archive. So, and you know, if I try to look at something that's say 25 years of my life, Mona keeps popping up again and again. And maybe that's the way the projection needs to be. And maybe to really just say that I can go up to a projection, I might introduce some sound, but sound is a whole other field in itself. So I have failed at making that film, but my admiration for sound and film people has gone up even more than before. Photography is, it's different. I thought it would seamlessly just happen. Yeah, but it was wonderful in your film.
Thank you.
Devan, both Navina and Dayanita are such a dear friend, and I quite know their work and the way they work. But it's just sharing to all of you. I think, Navin, I remember, I think probably Sudhir also had asked you a question when you had this film shown in Bombay. But I have been thinking about it, that during the time when, of course, such a short life Amrita had, but already, she went to Ajanta, she went to South, but there was a Bengal school solidly working, you know, with, and Rabindranath was very much there. I mean, Rabindranath present is still exists today for us, you know, in a big way. So, and he was painting exactly at that time. Abnindranath was there, and Nandal Babu and Vinod Bihari, all this. So that whole, that Bengal school working and as a trying to, you know, revive or a new thing, and that never sort of touched, or she didn't go that side, she didn't see that, or I mean, if you know, or well, any letters or any notes, or whether she was familiar with.
She didn't. Unfortunately, she never went to Calcutta. If she had gone there, then she would have found out about Shantiniketan. She obviously knew about Rabindranath Tagore, and she refers to him also.
Okay.
She says that he writes piddling poetry, but he draws better, you know, because she was very caustic in her remarks. But she was acidic and devastatingly acidic about the Bengal school. This was for her the absolute epitome of the worst type of. And Bivan, in these fabulous books of letters that he's brought out with the annotation, he says, "What would have happened if she had gone to Shantiniketan and met with?" I think there was Vinod Bihari, Mukherjee, and people at that time who were, you know, doing sort of similar things that would have interested her. Also with Ramkinkar Bage and people. But it didn't happen, and she just stuck with that. And what was this rather effete imitation of the Bengal School of Art, which was at that stage. And she never went to Bengal, to the chagrin of the Bengalis, who feel very hurt about the Bengal School of Art not being appreciated. But she had the same about, also the, you know, the Bombay School of Art, she wasn't very. So it was that period, and I think she was slightly isolated also, in the sense of living in this, in the sticks there in Saraya and Gorakhpur. Later, when she moved to Lahore in September 41, if she had lived, then I'm sure, because that was then the hub of the intellectual and you know what was happening. So there would definitely have been a greater interaction between her surroundings and so forth.
You know, you have this vast pool of experiences that you can dip into, which is available to us and available to Amrita at that time, as mentioned. But there are also inclinations and proclivities, what you respond to. There was a time when she responded to the Ajanta murals, frescoes, and then she felt very attracted towards the miniature paintings. So I think, you know, the trajectory of an artist, where it makes the artist feel inspired, feel connected, feel that her experience has a resonance with the kind of work that existed at that time. So it could be a matter of choice also.
I think you're right. She mentions in one of the letters, which I find very interesting, she says, "I always meet the type of thing that I need at the time that I need it." For instance, then she was suddenly confronted with Bruegel and Renoir when she goes to Hungary in between. And there's, within this short period of the 8 years, she develops hugely. I mean, it's, you know, what she calls her romantic phase with the great melancholy eyes, and she's out of the psychological romanticism of what India is about very soon after her return. Then she moves on, she was Ajanta, and then she goes on to the miniatures. And if you see the last, you know, the unfinished painting, it's practically, it's getting more and more abstract. And she talks about, you know, these flat figures. And so it is a huge trajectory for her within a, encapsulated in a tiny space of time, if you think of the development. So apart from anything else, she was absolutely clear on where she was going. It could also be the, you know, the elan of youth. We were all like that in the 20s. The world belonged to us, and we knew where we were going, and we were very definite about our opinions. There was very little sort of, in that sense, self-questioning, on a different level, but you knew where you were going. And, of course, she has this unfortunate, and yet, on the other hand, she's frozen into this time warp of, you know, 28. I mean, that's nothing. That's nothing. And in the year 1941, when we were still very much in the colonial period, it was, you know, with a nationalistic fervor and all sorts of other things of which she was reacting, because an artist doesn't only, you know, it has to reflect in the work. And the fact that she was together with Nehru and Chamanlal and all these people, so there's a lot of the nationalism that also goes into her work. But, you know, it's a question of choice, possibly, all, and she didn't, she, as I said in her letters, she's devastatingly acidic about the Bengal School of Art. So it could be, didn't interest her.
I think then, when you started working, and the way we are familiar with your work for all these years, I mean, Sabka Baap, Cartier-Bresson, you know, the photographs by Bresson, which we are familiar, and particularly a country like India, and then we have our own Raghubir Singh and Raghu Rai, you know, two giants working. There is always this temptation to be on the street and take picture of people, you know, can be black and white, Raghubir worked in color, but we noticed that you had a departure in the sense that Anand Bhavan, Mani Bhavan, or the file pictures now, and many, you know, I mean, they're all the Parsis and the Bengal ladies, all this, they're precise subject which you chose and you shot, but you never have photographs which are like, you know, the way say Raghu, I don't mean that you should be doing like Raghu Rai or Raghuveer Singh, but so there must be some moment when you actually started working and decided, you know, after doing photographs of Zakir Hussain, and decided I'm going to be a photographer, and glamorize my thing. So what was, which point or which moment it was it that you decided this is the way you are going to be different? In fact, in that context, I feel you are very closer to Umrah Singh's photograph. You know?
Yeah. That's
rather than the, you know, in between the...
No, I've always...
You follow what I'm saying? I'm like,
I've always maintained that if we had known Umrah Singh's photography earlier, you know, we only got to know Umrah Singh's photography...
In the late...
90s.
Late,
but that 80s. Too with Vivan's intervention. But Umrah Singh's work...
Came then a little later.
Sometime in 2000, no?
Yeah.
The book was made. No, later.
Mid 2000.
Okay. So if Umrah Singh and Nasreen Mohammadi's work had been more accessible, photography in this country would be at such a different level. We had two schools starting, you know. It's just that it didn't become a school. But Umrah Singh could be one school of photography and Nasreen Mohammadi another school of photography. Those, unfortunately, schools didn't happen, but yes, the great Cartier-Bresson came to India and left such a stamp on India that it became, there was for many years, I think Sadanand will bear me out on that, there wasn't another way to really photograph other than in the decisive moment way. The book, I spoke about Jeff Dyer before. His history of photography is called Ongoing Moment. And I think I subscribe more to the ongoing moment. And as far as Raghu and Raghubir Singh, they have both done what they did so well. Like, who can really have the courage to do street photography after Raghubir Singh in color? He's done it so well. So why add to what is already there? So it was that kind of situation. But the empty spaces happened, I can in my diary even tell you the day probably. Because I was in Goa photographing Mrs. Braganza and she left the room to answer the phone. So I was really irritated because, you know, it was hot and I was trying to take a picture and then she goes off, she's old and walking slowly and I thought, you know. And then I looked at the room and it was even more busy without her. And that's when all these empty spaces started, or I used to call them empty spaces. And I was together with somebody who I wanted to show sort of details. So it was a combination of both the factors that, okay, Sunil would really like to see this chair. And then at the same time feeling, I called it very dramatically, peopled by unseen generations. And that's really when, that was the point when the empty spaces started. But yes, if we had had a Umrah Singh school of photography, you know, we speak about the Dusseldorf school of photography. I think there was a great school of photography possible with Umrah Singh. And it might still happen. And Nasreen Mohammadi. And again, Nasreen sort of went too fast. And, you know, that's anybody passing through Delhi, please don't miss the show at the Kiran Nadar Museum. Mm. With Nasreen Mohammadi's work and Amrita.
There's a small section there.
But, you will agree with me, no? Yeah. Can you imagine a Nasreen Mohammadi school of photography? And those photograms and that eye that she had. So, when I came to photography, the models were Cartier-Bresson, Raghurai, Raghubir Singh. I got to know Umrah Singh too late, but yes, I do feel very close to him.
Thanks.
All right, for a question to Dayanita, I would like to remind Atul that it was 81 when Ram Kinkar died. He died and that night there was no one there at his deathbed except Kshatriyit Ray at the PG hospital in Kolkata. And so you expect people to recognize him in the 30s and the early 40s. It was too early because they were born around 1906-7, Shai Lohs, Vinod Bihari, Ram Kinkar and all that. So it was too early and she was only 28. So, and there were only a group of few young students from the local art college, the government art college in Calcutta, those who took him to the Banninghat the next day. And there was no one from Shantiniketan. He was not even recognized in Shantiniketan till the 80s. You know how his sculpture Rabindranath was treated with? It was dumped. And later, by forceful intervention of Satyajit Ray, it was, you know, just brought to that white queue or whatever. And just apart from that, I mean, this is a very so bad history. And I would like to, well, you mentioned about how do we, suppose if I, as a photographer, want to write poetry, say, a literature, because long time, say, at least 30 years back, the logocentric renaissance view of paintings or photography have been effaced out. And, you know, the so-called institution of art has opened up to crucial disciplines like photography, linguistics. So people, say, journalism, cinema, theater, psychoanalysis, linguistics. So people straddle from one space to the other in abandon. So everything is kind of a visual text. Even an image can be a poetry, an image can be a literature. So the so-called institution of art has totally opened up to the so-called bourgeois discipline of arts. So people straddle, the creative people straddle, I mean, the art practitioners, they straddle from one space to the other. So why not?
I mean, I'm listening to you and I agree with what you're saying. Why not what?
Why not? I mean, even a photographer is a poet.
Right.
I mean, even he's also a literary critic.
No, I should just say, I wasn't saying poetry in a literal way.
Mm.
I was saying if we look to the form, if I look at how Arvind Mehrotra writes poetry, if I look at Ondaatje, what I learned from Ondaatje is not how to write a story, but it's about withholding, what Ondaatje holds back from us, or from traveling with classical musicians. So one is to look at other forms in literature and to say, can we aspire to that? As try to build something with the photography, something more than the image, because that one image, one poetic photo is not enough for me.
That is the relation between the signifier and signifier. The author is dead. So I create. So I become the Ondaatje when I read Ondaatje's novels or texts or whatever, say literature. So I become the author myself.
So I'm just giving you more clues to the story when I put a piece together. And it's an experiment to see if it can hold out or not. I don't know. But it's an experiment because I'm tired of photography the way, just the taking of pictures is no longer enough. I know we are speaking at cross purposes, but it's okay.
No, but we are going to have Nanak amongst us the day after. It's going to be, I think, a very interesting session. Day after, Nanak Ganguly is sitting along with Sadanand Menon and Vivan Sundaram. I think every evening has to come to a close. But before I thank Dayanita and Naveena, I must tell you that tomorrow evening we have a very interesting session. First with Anju Dodia, she's going to present her work, then Sadanand Menon, then they will enter into a dialogue. You can imagine from this evening what will happen tomorrow when there is, you know, this kind of a dialogue between two greatly intellectually inclined and gifted, talented artists and writer. But on Sunday, we have three sessions. First session will be Alka Pandey, Atul Dodia, and Tasneem Mehta, all three different kinds of people, but in a way somehow related somewhere. They will talk about their work, then they will talk about, you know, Atul Dodia's work in the discussion. Then we'll have Rubina Karori. She'll be talking about your work also, the Kirinadar Museum. She's mentioned the dream, love dream, what is the title?
Difficult
love. So, and then Rubina and Kishore Singh, they will be discussing. Unfortunately, we will be missing Girish Shahane. He injured his foot, his ankle, twisted. He braved it out yesterday. He was here, but this morning he left for Delhi. He had a lecture at the National Modern Art Gallery. He was supposed to come, but he today apologized. He's gone back to Bombay, going back to Bombay. He won't be able to come. So, but we'll have Bhavana Kakkar sharing the stage with them. Then after that, of course, I've talked to you about Sadanand and Vivan Sundaram. But see, when we are talking about photography, you must have seen through the last four evenings when we had photography as a dominant factor amongst the presenters. We had Pushmala N, then we had Sheba Chachi, then now we had photography based work by Naveena, then we had Dayanita. So it's just a statement in itself that how photography has made inroads into all kinds of visual expression. Mm-hmm. But then you see if you imagine a canvas like 100 years ago or maybe 60 years ago, a lady, a gifted painter, Amrita Shergill, then we have a continuity of that. We can touch Naveena there, then we'll have Vivan there, we have their images, we have their paintings, and it's just a history kind of woven together in such a beautiful manner that we can experience a different kind of a feeling altogether. We see the paintings, we see Amrita Shergill's pictures, then we have those, the exhibition which we've been talking about, Umrao Singh Shergill's exhibition. I wonder how many of us have seen that. It's a beautiful exhibition, along with the retake of Amrita by Vivan Sundaram. So we have been so lucky and fortunate to have them all here together. Vivan is going to be here, Naveena is here, the young, talented, gifted, most gifted photographers, artists, writers, critics are here. We are so obliged to you. Thank you so much once again. Come again.
Congratulations. It was really
thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
And I'm thankful to Gallery Photo Inc., Devika Daulat Singh, who has been instrumental in providing this exhibition to us, which is actually owned by Sundaram family, Naveena and Vivan. I'm thankful to them, and I'm thankful to many others which I might have forgotten. Now, you can continue discussing with all of them outside over chai. Thank you so much. Come again tomorrow. Thank you.
Just one more word. I think we should really, while we are thanking everybody, really thank Divan Manna for getting this superb panel together in such a short time. And I mean the entire week. And it's been at very short notice and wonderful. Thank you.